We're a recruiting consulting company that works with startup tech companies in Boston to help them recruit, work on their employment brand, employment process, and really whatever else they need help with. So we have a great panel here today of some of my clients and partners. So the first thing that I'd like to do is to let everybody introduce who you are, who you work for, and your role with the company. We'll start with you.
How are you doing? I'm Nick Morris. I'm the Director of Business Development over at RefralMom.
I'm Anthony Habayeb, Senior Vice President of Strategy and Development at Propel Marketing.
Hi, I'm Vasilios Alexiou, co-founder of FirmPlay.
I'm Peter Pavlovich. I'm the principal architect of the Innovations Delivery Lab at Enernoc.
I'm Justin Bakes. I am co-founder and CEO of Forward Financing.
I'm Mike Palladino. I'm the donor insight advisor at Evertrue.
Great, excellent. So the subject of discussion today will be what it's like to work in a startup, what it takes to succeed in a startup. We have some questions for the panel, and if we have some time at the end, we'll open it up to the audience for some Q&A. So our first question is for all of you, so we'll do the same thing and go down the line here. What's the best part of working at your company? Tell us a little bit about the company and the best part about working there.
Okay, so Referral Mob, which is a new talent acquisition mobile app. I think the best part about working at the company is the ability to help a lot of people involved in having a whole new concept. We're able to speak with a lot of great companies and show them a new way to find new talent at a much more affordable price. So a lot of startups in an area that might not have the funds, they can find people much more efficiently. We're able to have that whole freelance economy and assist people in referring candidates that they know onto the app and make money on the side by using their own professional network. And all people that are looking for jobs, we make an easy, efficient way for them to look and find new people on the app while making additional sign-on bonus and making it very easy to do the process and apply to multiple positions. So, really switching gears, great environment. It's just been an exciting place to be a part of.
Yeah, so Propel Marketing, I sort of like to think that we're a very fortunate startup in that we operate with probably a lot of the same challenges that everybody here is trying to be really lean, right? We really try to, everybody has a lot of opportunity to have tremendous impact, but we have the opportunity of being really incubated inside of a larger media company. So things that we build, strategies that we develop have immediate access to a huge marketplace. So when we're trying to help our core customers who are small and medium business owners, right? It's a really confusing market for business owners to go out there and figure out, how do I do this digital marketing thing? Some of them know, right? And some of them don't, but they all need some degree of help. And that's what Propel Marketing tries to do, is just ask a business owner, what are your goals? And then we translate that into digital marketing. And the access that we have is, I have 2,000 salespeople in newspapers in 32 states. So I have great brand equity and marketplace access to bring all of my products and services to market immediately. So, Propel really provides this great opportunity of the stress and the struggle of building in really lean and nimble environments at Propel. We stress ourselves every day to operate as efficiently as possible, but everything that we do then has immediate, really material marketplace access, and that's a really fortunate opportunity.
Yeah, so I think we're probably a little bit of an outlier because we're the smallest company on this panel. We're four or five people, depending on how you count us. And what that means is we have to move super fast with things, and we can. So we think in terms of days or weeks instead of months and quarters. For instance, we came up with an idea just a month ago, for instance, and we mocked up the idea in PowerPoint. We didn't write a single line of code. We didn't build anything. The next day, we had talked to a bunch of customers to see if this idea was something that they wanted. And by the end of the week, because customers had started to actually pay for this, mind you, this is all still in PowerPoint, they had put down money, then we started to build at the end of the week. So to me, that kind of, that speed, that kind of environment, personally, is something that I like to move, like to be in and sort of work with. It can be a little bit hectic at times, so there's definitely downsides, but I'd say that's probably the best part, is just the speed with which you can do things.
So I think I'm probably on the other end of the spectrum. Enernoc is about a 1,400 person company. We've been around for 12 years, and yet we're still a startup, at least in our minds. So every day, We come to work. Everybody in the company is on board, all in, wearing way too many hats than is even sane. But it is so much fun, and you learn so much every day. And as a result of that kind of innovation and dedication by everybody at the company, last year we saved our companies like $1 billion in power and saved like 77 power plants from having to build or some unbelievable impact like that. It is such a great company to work at. If you really want to succeed at this kind of a company, and I think at any startup, another thing that I do in my particular role is I work with a company called Greentown Labs. Anybody heard of them before? A couple people? So Greentown Labs is an incubator facility at which there's about 50, 55 green energy related startups, all in one under one roof. And it is the most amazing experience to be part of that. Enernoc is a corporate sponsor of that, so I'm usually there at least one day every other week. I have office hours there, and I work with all of these startups and help them do whatever it is that they need to do. If they just need to bounce ideas off me, if they need to run business plans by me, if they need me to help them pair program something or help them design something, I'm there for that. So I think the most important thing that I've seen is that you have to be willing to wear multiple hats. And if you want a startup to be interested in you, the more hats you can demonstrate that you can wear, the more likely it is they're going to value you. So,
thanks. So Ford Financing, we are a small business lending company. So there's 28 million small businesses throughout the U.S. And our goal is to help them get financing and provide it to them. So banks are declining. Banks don't provide financing to the majority of businesses. And we approve about 90% that qualify basically above some certain threshold. So we're 60 people, 45 people downtown Boston. We're started down here in Boston. And just, I think the benefits of working for a startup, I think that was the question.
Yeah, you were down the panel. Sorry about that.
But I think the benefits of working for a startup is you're never going to learn anything. You're going to learn the most in that role out of any other position you have. You have to be resourceful. You have to be hungry. You want to, like you said, wear a lot of hats. You get the benefit of helping mold a culture and a team and group of people. It's a lot of fun. You have to love the people you work with. But I think overall, it's at least for myself and our team, is you'll never learn more and build your toolbox for what you kind of go on to do later on in life if you're not sticking with the startup that you did. But that's the most amazing part, I would say, to it.
Cool. Well, easy being the last one to echo a lot of the sentiments that my co-panelists have said. Evertrue, which is where I work, is a Boston company. We're about 75 people. We help the nonprofit market, which is always a daunting market to enter into because they never buy technology. And I do sales there, so it gets really fun. But really what Evertrue does is we help the nonprofit market, specifically the fundraising teams, raise more money for their organizations. So we wed institutional data with social indicators that people are self-reporting on things like LinkedIn and Facebook and so on and so forth, Zillow. We bring it all together and deliver it in a technology that doesn't look like it's from the 80s, which is largely what they usually use. The best part about coming to work for me, having been the fourth hire to a 75-person company, which probably echoes a lot of what the rest of the group said here, is just it's a community of learners, not only at Evertrue, but also I think at events like this. The exposure that you get to like-minded people that are eager to work hard, you know, be a combination of persistent but also patient and understand that there's going to be challenges along the way, that personally not only I think helps the individuals grow as professionals, but also just bring a whole other set of, you know, skills to the entire marketplace of like-minded people. So yeah, it's an honor to be here just because, you know, working at a startup company, it's not only about your own company, it's about this community of companies that you get exposure to, and it's about bouncing ideas back off of. So that's been the best part about my job so far.
That's great. Totally agree. So one of the things that Jason said was you spend a lot of time with the people that you work with, and you really need to like them. They really become part of your family. So one of the questions I have is what it's like in an early stage company in terms of socializing with your colleagues and spending that amount of time with them. So, Mike, I'd like to address that to you.
Sure. So that's a great question because it's very hard for me to separate work from play oftentimes. I like to say that Evertrue is kind of like my Evertrue family, my fiance. Probably would think otherwise, considering that I bring homework with me pretty much every day. But I think, you know, from a culture standpoint, we make sure that we hire people that we want to spend time with. It's either long hours in the day or even if you're not at the office, still communicating with each other. And once again, I think just from a culture standpoint, in order to get ahead, you have to not only like and respect the people that you're working with, and I'm sure just like the rest of the panelists, you know, hiring people that not only you like to spend time with at work, but also afterwards. It's about finding that balance. It's about professionalism in the office, but also I think for a lot of startup companies, it's a work hard, play hard environment. You work hard, you celebrate the victories, but you also have to go through the defeats as well, and that's really for, I think, my perspective as someone that came from a big corporate kind of office beforehand. It's just been a lot different. It's been a little bit of a different transition, but yeah, I mean, I have two of my coworkers in my wedding, so that says anything about kind of the environment. Yeah, it's been good.
Vasilios, can you comment on that too? So you have a really small group, so you guys are obviously very close, and you also see a lot of startup companies, so you could probably comment on what that...
Yeah, I failed to mention in my introduction that what we do. FirmPlay helps companies showcase their company culture through photos and videos so that they can hire better. So if you go to firmplay.com, you'll see what I'm talking about. Essentially, company profiles that are very visual and show you what it's like at the company. And so in doing that, I think, you know, what we've found, so personally, what it's like for us and what we've seen at other places, very similar sentiments that a lot of the there's almost like sometimes it feels like I might be bipolar when I'm at work because, you know, things go up and down, as I said, very quickly. And I think I see, not every company that we work with is as small as us, but I sense the ups and downs when I talk to people and they explain what their day-to-day is like. You can hear, and you can see some of the videos on the site, you can hear that they do celebrate the ups and the downs. I don't know. It can be hard. I don't think it's right for everyone. I do want to just kind of, part of what I wanted to, I was thinking about what I was going to say when I came here is, it's startups are kind of sexy, cool, and everyone wants to do them, but they're not necessarily right for everyone. And that part, that sort of the ups and downs, I think it's really important to know that that's a big part of what you're going to get. So I'm not sure if I'm adding anything really different, but I'm just expanding a little bit on, that really, the ups and downs really is, I see that across the board at startups. From the very small ones up to, 500, 1,000 people, and even maybe a little bit beyond, so.
Yeah, we see that all the time with our clients. It just changes day to day, hour to hour, and there's definitely celebrations, but disappointments too, so. So that being said, Nick, what, you work with a lot of startups, too. What would you say is the hardest thing, in your opinion, about working at a startup?
Well, I mean, I think the hardest thing for working at a startup is the interpretation of the person, and this may be a good way to sort of filter yourself for a startup. It's probably the change and having to switch gears and work on the fly. Personally, for myself, I love that, and I love being able to wear multiple hats and always be going in 15 different directions. But that's probably what tends to be really hard. If, you're not just going to work and knowing your particular job and your particular company's direction and siloed to exactly what you're going to do, you have to go in multiple directions, and all of a sudden you might switch gears one week and then the next week go a completely different way, and you have to be okay with that and have to realize how we're going to do this most efficiently. So that's a good sort of a test right there to see how you feel, and if that's something that's a negative for your environment, probably not want to be in a startup. So.
That makes sense. Justin, can you comment on that too? What do you think the hardest part is?
So, hard part about working on a startup, I mean, I think, was the fun part. That's the question. But the hard part, I guess, is it's echoing that. It's being open to change, right? Is in a startup, we're 3 years old. I could name five different people in our organization that have had five different positions. They were hired for something that we thought was the role. They turned into being an asset for something else. And we're very, very flexible of moving. And so as part of founder and leadership is to identify people's roles and what they want to be doing. And moving them along that way. So you might have an idea and have a career track record, but being in a startup, you do have to be flexible, at least be open to it, to move towards your strengths or what the business needs are. So I would say it's a challenge, but that's also fun. And I think as you're being interviewed and considering a startup, I think it's just as important to be interviewing who your potential employer is going to be, and understand that business and understand the different roles and know as going into it that will be a challenge and potentially turn that into an opportunity.
Yeah, that's definitely a quality that the interviewer looks for. And obviously you guys are here and want to understand how to make yourself more marketable. So Peter, can you talk a little bit about the type of qualities that you look for when you're interviewing candidates?
Yeah. Well, obviously there has to be some base skills, right? So you want to research what it is the company's doing and make sure that you have at least a couple of check marks that you can put against their want list. But I think in our case, we're really looking for people with the ability to think on the fly, to apply creative reasoning. I mean, problem solving is probably the most important skill to have no matter what job you have. If you are a good problem solver, if you can come up with innovative ways to get around roadblocks, and the basic ability to be able to research, because like Google is your friend in just about every aspect of startup mentality. So those are qualities that we look for. You also have to be incredibly flexible. You want to be a go-getter. You want the people to be self-starters, right? So are these people, so for one thing, so I'm a software architect. So when I interview somebody, the first thing I do is I want to go and ask them what's their name on GitHub. And I want to go and see what projects they've been contributing to. Have they got some projects out there? Have they been working in the open source community? Because if you're going to work for me or work with me, I want to make sure that you live, breathe, and eat this stuff. That this is a passion for you, that you can't stop coding. I mean, you're constantly thinking, you're constantly creating in your own mind, you're looking for new opportunities, you're thinking about how you can improve things process-wise. These are all really good, strong qualities that you need to bring to the table. But another thing you want to think about too is your longer term strategic plan. So when you're looking at a company to go work for, even if they don't have a position that is your ideal position, if you can get a position that's close or that's in the same ballpark, and you can get in there, prove yourself, and then make your case to the founders that, hey, look, this is a position I think that we need here. I think, and when you're in a company, keep your eyes open for opportunities that you think you can contribute to, and make your case. Don't wait to be asked. I mean, that's going to go so far, and I know there's some founders on here as well, but I mean, if somebody comes to me and says, hey, I think this is a great idea, I think we should do it, I mean, that's why I'm here today. I went to my leadership and I said, hey, somebody contact me, thought this was a good idea. I think it is too. And they said, okay, you own it, go do it, right? I had an idea to go down to Carnegie Mellon University this weekend and run a hackathon. I proposed the plan and now we're doing it. I've got a team of 5 guys going down with me. We've got 150 students signed up. We've got the whole faculty down there involved. That never would happen if I hadn't gone and said, stepped out on a ledge and took the risk of possibly being rejected, but made the case. And you have to be willing to step out of your comfort zone, but that's the only way you're going to learn, and that's the only way you're going to grow too. So all of those kinds of qualities are what I think I find attractive in a candidate.
Makes sense. Thank you. Anthony, can you comment on that as well? You guys are hiring like crazy, so what qualities do you look for?
I think one of the things that probably everybody here tries to do is
So what I would say is hopefully what you're going to hear from anybody at my company, I think all of us in trying to grow really fast, we really try to establish some like common, what do you look for? And at least in our company, people who have failed, right? So you're out there interviewing and you're talking to people and you're spending all this energy, like, here's the great stuff that I've done. But I actually feel like I learned the most about somebody when they walk me through like how they failed before. They're not scared to fail, right? As you're growing really fast, you're going to make mistakes. I don't care, right? I actually want to hear about the time you had like this horrible screw up personally or professionally, and how'd you rebound from it? What'd you do? Right? I think I learned more about somebody from that experience. I could tell you some horrible college experiences that I thought I was done for, and here I am, right? And being able to articulate your failures is actually a really telling thing, and I really challenge people to tell me about how they failed, and I don't look for that packaged, like, oh, I'll tell you about my biggest weakness example that I think you get a lot in interviews. I can sort of, I feel that I've interviewed enough to be able to tell the difference in that. I think the other really important thing too is that on the opposite side of failure is that you're obsessed about your success, right? You can show something that maybe it's an instrument that you have like managed your whole life to be like unbelievably proficient at playing the violin, right? Or like you've like obsessed with your being a member in GitHub and being in that community and every day walking down the street, thinking about like what permutation could I develop to make crossing the street better, right? Like there's all of these things that like you just obsess about, right? So that obsessive tendency is a great skill because that tells me you're going to come in and the thing that you're responsible for, the thing that you're most excited about in the world that we're playing in, you're going to come in and like completely like be on the bone and try to do some amazing things with that. So those are a couple of characteristics that I'd say I try to get from people in conversations.
Okay, great. That's awesome. What about you, Mike? What do you look for when you've hired a lot of people since you were number four?
Yeah, we have. I think, you know, thick skin's a big one, which kind of also echoes kind of the sentiments that they said. It's about people that can take constructive criticism and use it as a motivation to follow their passion. Because not only, you know, what we expect, and I think a lot of startup companies, the only way you can operate is with transparency and communication. And whether you're the CEO or you're a brand new BDR rep right out of college, we expect you to raise your hand if you see something that's not working right. But also, if someone tells you that they don't think that something's working efficiently, to have that open communication and not let it get you down. You know, I can't tell you how many times I've had, you know, not my wrists slapped, but people that have said, hey, I don't think that this is the right way to do it. Let's talk about it. And not only is that going to help me professionally grow, but it's also just going to help the company in general. So I think the biggest thing is, do you have thick skin? Are you willing to take constructive criticism and feed off of that to add to that passion? And ultimately, you know, that's how the entire company will benefit from, you know, like-minded learners teaching each other and working with each other. I think that's the biggest thing that we look for. In addition, we work in the nonprofit sector, so we like people that are empathetic, that have the ability to, you know, kind of not, we like aggressive salespeople, but also with an empathetic undertone, because we're selling to people that, you know, are for the most part pretty empathetic.
Great. Anybody else on the panel have anything to add about what kind of people they think do well at a startup or traits? Feel free to jump in.
I'll mention we have a pretty structured interview process on how we do phone screens in person and then a follow up interview, and each one has, and if you go through, and companies that do hire a lot have follow different models. One thing that we look for, and especially if you're hiring new grads that might not even have work experience, but is a history of success and moving up. So if you've had a job for 3 years, we want to see that you've moved from tier one to tier two to tier three. I would strongly suggest if you have that on your resume, you have one employer, but detail out that upward movement. Talk about, even if it's in something in school, if it's back to high school, college, find those things where you've been dragged by somebody, a professor dragged you along because you're a standout. Those are the really type things, because smart people can do anything, and if you've shown that track record and whatever it is and can kind of discuss it and make it known, that's a huge asset.
Cool. Yeah, that's great.
One other thing that I would add. I mean, when we were looking for a developer to take over the technical side of the business last year, and what I was looking for, and not just, this doesn't apply to just you know, programming, but anything really, is just evidence. It's so easy nowadays to, if you say you're a marketer or a design person, right, to just mock something up, to build something, a side project, and then that's what you take. That's when you say, I want to do this, I want to get into marketing, I want to be in sales. Well, show evidence of where you've pitched something or where you sold something or you've marketed something. I mean, it's so easy nowadays, I think, to build that kind of a portfolio. So I wouldn't, to me, honestly, it just doesn't matter so much where someone went to school or even really what they studied. It really just matters like what you've done and can you prove that there's something there when you say that's what you want to do in the future.
So everybody here in the audience is obviously looking to target startups, but what does startup mean? Is it funding? Is it size? How long the company's been in business? I'll go back to you, Vasilis, to comment on that.
Yeah, we've seen a lot of startups. I think we've spoken with hundreds of startups in the Boston space. And the one, this is really soft, but just right off the bat, I think the one thing that defines a startup is just the mentality of the place. And by that, I mean, I think you might have said it. It's really, is everyone, I don't know how to say this, but so I came from a bigger company, from Accenture, before I did this, and it's 200,000 people. And I can tell you, I don't think everyone was very much on the same page. They had their silos, they had their department, and that was kind of it. That was the company for them. But with a startup, it's, while it's still at the point where you feel like you're responsible for the whole company in a way that you really have a hand in everything. So the person who's in product management, you know, you're going to be working with them, and the person who's in sales, you're going to be working with them, and you're responsible for their success, they're responsible for your success. Like, it's this, you know, it's very, again, very soft, kind of kumbaya kind of stuff, but the mentality, I don't want to say like it's when you've raised this much money or when you're this big or this small, or even how many years you've been around. That stuff is all kind of fluid. I really do think it's the mentality.
What's your opinion on that?
So I thought about this a little bit, and I was thinking, you know, obviously, like Silas and I, under 10 people in our company, you know, Peter has 1,500 people, you know, in a company like that, and it's still a startup. So it can't be money. It's not revenue. It's not funding. But I think it's the idea, and it's the power that, and the weight of that idea, and how much it can carry in your organization. You have to be open to having an idea and realizing that you can bring something to the table to help your team and help other teams along to help have something be more efficient and move forward. And then the weight of that idea, you have to have a team around you that's going to listen to that idea, that you can actually change gears, you can move directions, you can be agile and switch, and that people are open to hearing your idea and you're not afraid to tell that idea to your team if you think it can help. They may decline and say it's not right. They may tell you why you should go in a different direction. They may see that and find there's little ways that they can grow up on top of that and move it in a certain way or use it in a different aspect. But that idea just weighs so heavily in a startup, and that idea of the culture that you're surrounded by there is what makes a startup that can be millions worth of revenue or be 3 weeks old and three people in a basement. But it's all in that same concept that you're all sort of going towards the same direction and want to have those ideas that's going to have success.
Yeah, a startup's, to piggyback on, a startup's mission is, I mean, that's everything. That's what everyone is driving toward. I think that's maybe a different way to say what you're saying. It's just, I totally agree with that.
It's passion. It's passion. I mean, and when I moved from an organization I was at and started and joined this organization, very happy where I was at. Everything was fine, but I saw this. I was, you know, excited about it. I had a lot of adrenaline towards it. I thought it was a very great concept, and I have that passion instilled in me. I go every single day wanting it to be better, seeing what aspects I can make it better, not just in business development and sales, in a product meeting, in the user interface, in the user experience, with the marketing team, wherever I can help, where I come up with an idea, I'm not afraid to say it, and there's someone there to listen. And, you know, they compile all those ideas, and hopefully you're moving towards a better product.
And I'll say that the two things that, from all of that I also would like to stress is the vision is really important, but if I'm looking for a startup that I want to go work for, I want to hear that vision from the leader, and I want to hear it in a way that makes me want it. And if they can't make me feel that, then it's not going to happen, and I don't want to be part of a failure. So at least going in. And the other thing too is what makes a startup is the ability for you to express your ideas and have them heard all the way to the top. So the fewer layers that you have to go through, the closer to a startup you are. So if I can go right to the CEO basically and say, I got a great idea, I want you to hear it, then to me, that's a startup. And that's the way it is at Enernoc, so.
Right. Anthony, can you chime in on that?
I think these guys sort of covered
okay.
it. It was healthy,
yeah.
exhaustive. The one thing you're gonna, I challenge any one of you to go to an interview right now, and the hiring manager's not gonna throw the word startup at you. Right. And so I think listen to sort of what you heard from these guys as far as like how do you really sniff out. I think the biggest element is culture, right? What a startup's trying to do. There's all different elements of
yeah.
startups, right? But what they're trying to do is just really like empower people to build something, right? To have this accountable culture. And I think you really want to challenge, you're interviewing the company. If that's the environment you want, then you're really asking questions about environment. You're asking like, what's an example of an employee that maybe has some core competency or role you're asking them to do that then went and did something else? Right? Or what is the PowerPoint example? What's a product that you maybe wireframed and had to market in like 2 weeks? Like those are really like small scale things, but then on the flip side you might have somebody like brought a product to market and all of a sudden like it's a $1 million product line, but only two or three people did. Like it's gonna be all different scales, but I think that level of like cultural entrepreneurship, right? The office that we're in here, right? Like Microsoft, you're interviewing Microsoft, they're gonna tell you like we have hundreds and thousands of little startup businesses across our entire company. We're not just Microsoft. So you're really just looking for that collegial environment where people are gonna challenge each other and try to build something together towards a common purpose.
So we have, I'm going to make an executive decision and go 10 minutes over and see if anybody has any questions for the panel. Happy to answer those now.
No questions at all?
Wow, you guys covered everything, I guess.
Okay. Tell me about the requirement for facial hair.
In 3 more days, you get a different answer from me.
I haven't shaved in years, so I'm just too lazy at this point.
I shaved just for you guys this morning, but normally I don't.
Yeah,
I grew beard after I quit my job, so I haven't shaved since.
I blame it on Vikings. My wife just loves the show, and she suggested it, so.
That's funny. And he's getting married.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
He's got a whole different set of rules.
It's getting cold too. You need that little face blanket.
Yeah.
The number coming up also.
Yeah.
Yep.
Remember.
Okay. Yep. Go right in.
Hey guys.
Hi.
Do you think that you could do a career change as you enter a startup, or is that something that you should have worked out beforehand?
You mean change your career as you enter a startup,
yeah,
or
so
afterwards?
You're entering a startup and the role that you are applying for is something that you haven't.
I think absolutely. It goes back to resourcefulness, right? And hunger and ability to make decisions and think on your feet. It's in a young company, that's what you're looking for, right? It depends on your career and where you're coming into the company. But those I would say is the key traits, right? If you can prove those, exemplify those, and show kind of interest in other things, if you have those traits, you can do anything, right? Nothing. I don't think. I mean, maybe besides yours is, you know, you have coding and engineering, but and the majority of companies is you have to be smart and you can do anything, right? And have that attitude that you can conquer the world. If you have that, you really can do anything. And management, founders, everybody will and should see that and give you the reins to do that.
So I guess I actually did make a change. I went from financial services. I was an options and derivatives trader, and not a very good one, but I was doing it and not very happy. And then now I do sales and business development. So for me, I think, you know, I was really fortunate and just, you know, when I left college, and I'm 29 now, and you know, I've had 3 jobs, including Evertrue. I started off working at a school, then did some financial stuff. And I think for me, it was just, and I was always kind of told that by mentors that this was a good approach, you know, try something if you're interested in it, and you'll know intuitively if you're good at it or not, or if you're passionate about it. I wasn't passionate about it. And it was then reaching out to some folks like, you know, the CEO of Evertrue and just saying, hey, I'm passionate about your mission. I don't have any experience in sales, but I'm eager to learn. I'll absorb and I'll, you know, work for whatever you need. You know, if it's whiskey instead of health insurance, fine, I don't care. I just want to get in here. And the ability to be flexible, I think that's what gave me the opportunity to do it. And then it was also pretty good timing for me. But yeah, so it's, I think absolutely, you know, if you're passionate about something, just don't be afraid to make the change. And risk taking is also part of our business. So if you can make that risk and you're willing to do it, then that's also says a lot for you as an individual candidate. So
the best position for you going into a startup is one that has not been filled before. It's a brand new position. That means carte blanche. You can make it whatever you want it to be. All you have to do is justify it. I mean, they're obviously creating it because they have a need, but you can mold that position into what you want. So even a company as old as Enernoc, 12, 13 years old company, my position was brand new. And what it started out as and what it is now are a direct result of my influence over that position. And that's another thing when you're interviewing these companies, ask them about that kind of thing. Are they open to that kind of thing? If they are, then they are truly a startup. If they're more rigid, then they're not really a startup mentality, I think. I mean, most of the startups that I work with, they're totally flexible. I mean, whatever gets the job done, the as so many people have said, the vision is the driving force. And anything that helps that vision become reality is fair game.
Just one, you have to sell that yourself, right? So if I'm looking for a product director or looking for an engineering role or I'm looking for a marketing leader, am I going to probably skew towards somebody that has shown me they've done it before? Yeah, right? Every hiring manager is going to. But if you really have, I think that was a great example of you saw Everett Drew and said, you know what, I'm interested in this, right? But he probably then went in there and he articulated, like, this is how I've sold my friends. This is how I've sold things in the past. This is how I think I could be successful at some of the things that you need me to do. So I'm a huge believer. And if somebody comes to me and they're incredibly passionate about what it is that I'm doing, you immediately have my attention. Now just walk me down the path of how you think your passion or your skills or your experiences translate into this other thing. So you do need to know that, like, every hiring manager is going to skew towards somebody that probably has proven they've done it, because we're all in hyper growth mode. Like, we ideally want somebody that can come in and they can just hit the ground running. But if somebody can come in, you know what, I'm going to spend some time because they are so amped about what it is they're doing, that then we're so passionate about this together, and then they're going to take it from there. That's great, because that person has proven they have that much more runway to grow into versus somebody I'm hiring who's just obvious and doing it today. But you have to sell me on that, right? I might not automatically, like, make that next leap to, well, you know, I have this person that's been that product manager. They could probably do this role. They've shown me that they know how to do customer journeys and product briefs, but this person just really understands how to, like, listen to a customer and ask questions and turn those things into solutions. I can teach them how to work in Agile, right? So
it's kind of one of those things sometimes where it's like, sometimes you learn bad habits from working in a particular job and doing a particular skill. And sometimes someone who's raw, when I would hire someone who's a sales or recruiting, you know, they might not have experience in that area, but they might just have bad habits from it that they think they know everything already. So proving that you actually have some core ability in to do a particular role and have the passion for it, even if you came from a different background, that's still showing something to a company that you might have a lot of a lot of space there and a lot of area for value for the company. And considering you're actually open to switching your career or switching to a different type of company or position, it shows that flexibility and that ability to change and possibly wear multiple hats. They might see some value in what you used to do before, and you might be able to be a resource in that area also. But it definitely gives that openness, because they don't want to get the person just has the pedigree or this or that. They need someone who's going to have results and actually work and do well for you. So,
okay. Right, we have time for one more question if anyone has one. Yeah.
Okay. As your company grows, how do you still maintain that startup culture? Because sometimes it happens that people, as your company grows, people get into a certain role, like some people are given a certain role and they are not allowed to be flexible. As you say that you should be able to wear many hats, but how do you keep that thing going? Do you have mini startups in a startup, or do you treat a project as a startup, or how do you keep that culture going, especially with 1,400 people? How would you do that?
Well, I'll give you one example. So our basically our CTO type VP came to our little group and said, we're moving into a different space. We've got our user conference coming up, and we're now able to sell our product without a salesman because of some of the things that we're doing differently. Wouldn't it be great if we had a portal that people could go to our users conference? We could have some kind of a kiosk there where they can sign up for our product. Yeah, that would be great. What do you think? Could we do it? It's like, yeah, sure, you know, we'll meet with product management and we'll come up with some plans and that, and we'll have it ready for next year. Well, I was thinking this year. Okay, so this is like on a Wednesday afternoon. And we said, well, but we have to pack and go to the conference next Friday. He said, yeah, but you know, we want a series of questions that'll help narrow down what product and everything else. We want it full, you know, they can enter a credit card and have it targeted and email all of your, you know, the full package, right? And it has to be mobile too, because we're going to have them on tablets and everything else. And we said yes. Despite the fact that it was just myself, one other developer, and one person to help us with the cloud deployment, because we had a bunch of other things that had to be done for that same event. So that kind of startup mentality, oh, by the way, we finished on Tuesday, but without working the weekend, by the way. Yeah, but it's just picking the right technology. But the whole point is that was super startup mode, right?
Sure.
Encourage that culture. Just one other example. We had two people in the company who had been with the company for years and years, and they finally decided to go and start their own company. Now, most companies would go traders, right? Just after they made the announcement, we had our quarterly company-wide meeting. The two founders, does everybody know where we are? We're in the One Marina Park Drive, big, beautiful building. We were on three floors of that building. And we announced at this meeting that, you know, we're moving into the fourth floor. Is it like the fourth floor of our block as well? And so they invited these two guys up. The two founders hugged them, you know, said what a great job they've done. They've been great contributors. And they announced that entrepreneurship is what got them started. And they are not going to stand in anybody's way. They're only going to support them. They want them to succeed. In fact, they want everybody to understand that it's all about entrepreneurship. So they named two of the conference rooms on the new floor after these people to remind everybody every day that this is what it's all about. So that kind of culture is what's going to make you a startup.
Great. Excellent. All right, so I guess we our time is up, so we'll wrap up, but everybody here has a booth in our pavilion area, so stop by and you can continue conversations, drop your resume off, see what they're hiring for. And I want to thank everybody here for joining me.
Thanks.